This is what I look like without my coffee. This is what I look like with coffee.
5:45 in the morning was your idea. What, do you keep bumping into things?
I need to find a Starbucks.
Where are you going?
Let's see what time they open. They're getting ready.
Which is where all the Alta Cockers come to stay.
The key Alta Cocker.
Yeah. And this is our last day in Belize, so I figured right now is as good a day time to debrief you on the vacation. But that thing that we did, the worst thing we did on the on this vacation has to be.
There we go.
Pina colada?
Yeah. Oh, he wants a pina colada. I've got the back.
That's okay. Right there. Anyway, the worst day was
Friday.
Saturday. It was a Saturday, which I don't know. You, I can't remember his name now, but they'll see it in the video. You cranky, I don't know.
Hugh, I thought it was Potter.
No. Perky. You Parky.
So this is the deal. We paid for a full day. We were going to go out to the private little island where Alex would get fitted for his snorkeling equipment and be given an introduction course. We would go out to one reef in the morning, come back for lunch. They would serve us lunch and then go back for a different reef in the afternoon and then return. So it was a full day. It would have given us two nice reefs.
So we get out there.
It seems that the wind is high, so they don't want to snorkel. But my take on it is that it's only the two of us and they can't fill a boat. So they're going to put us on the manatee's watch.
The manatee.
Manatee watch, which we don't want.
No, because we find that personally dangerous.
What?
Well, they might harpoon us.
They might harpoon you. Speak for yourself.
So what's the?
The word is that we are going to go out on the M watch.
Humanity watch.
Come back here for lunch.
Yeah.
And then do the reef in the afternoon.
They were sending us on
a manatee watch
boat.
Yeah.
Where we went with two other couples
from the Nuclear Regulatory Agency.
Who were really into it. They went with their binoculars
and they were standing on the edge of the boat looking out. Yeah.
We spent 3.5 hours in this boat.
Mangroves runs all the way south of the country. From the north part, it's running like that. And like I mentioned, when it's like an almost entire reef, it's because you find every little creature that lives on the reef spend his childhood or his juvenile life between these mangroves roots. So they protect themselves from predators. And then when they get a little bigger, they come out and they use the grass beds. And then they start moving on
to the reef.
To the reef.
It's a ray.
It's a ray.
We saw three stingrays. Wow.
It's very small. The male.
I can't tell the difference from
here. We saw a porpoise. Mmm, that's good. Can I have a sip of your pina colada?
Yeah. Anyway.
So we get out there and we're 3.5 hours watching for
manatees. And they're nowhere.
And they're nowhere. But we did.
He's going to every manatee bar that he knows, looking for manatees.
Every sinkhole that he can imagine.
Yeah.
And we're with these people that are standing up on the boat with their binoculars and their cameras.
Is there a stingray over there?
Yep.
Where?
At the bottom.
I don't even see him.
Yeah.
Where?
He's went that way. It was better. Thank you.
And then when it came to manatee, we either saw four manatees or one manatee four times.
Or two manatees.
He's two times.
Still there.
It's moving that way. There's this little snout that comes out of the water.
They come out for 30 seconds.
No, not even 30 seconds,
five seconds. To get their air, and then they're underwater for 5 more minutes.
Yeah.
So this is what we spent 3.5 hours.
Yeah, first it just was like right there, like.
Yeah. He's coming up for his breath. Where? Before.
Oh. Oh, I mean.
There's a fish down here.
Oh yeah. It looks like an eel. So this is what we spent 3.5 hours.
I could go to an aquarium and see. Or I could go back to you Parkey's main room.
They have their little
and
museum.
He has pictures of them.
Right. So now we get back. We had a lunch. It was okay lunch.
Yeah.
It was all right. And so the group that we were with went back to Belize City, and it left us. So we kept saying, you know, where is our snorkeling? Oh, we kind of forgot about us. Mm-hmm. But yes, we've got snorkels for you. So you say something.
Well, no, you're telling the story.
I don't tell it as funny.
Well,
so
finally they decide they have a guy who's going to take us out to the reef. Or what passes for a reef.
Right. And Alex never snorkeled before. So he gets his flippers, he gets his goggles, and he gets his mask. And he didn't really give him any...
He just said, hey, put the mask on, put this in your mouth, breathe through it. When you want to get air out of it, blow. Come on, let's go.
Alex looked like a fish out of water.
Well, I mean...
Well, you were. He put his legs over,
yeah,
ready to jump in the 4 feet of water that it was, and he got panicked. He said, maybe I should stay on the boat. He said, no, Alex, come try. we're getting to the good part. So, Alex...
I didn't find it that funny.
Jumps in the water and goes into a complete panic, and he little claustrophobic, and he wants to get off the boat. He's going. He wants to get off the boat, so we take his fins off and put them on the boat. He gets on the ladder. The ladder breaks. He broke the ladder.
The ladder was broken when I got there.
We tried, well, we'll get him over at the edge of the boat where the motor is, and then the guy tried to hoist him up.
There was no way of getting back in this boat.
It was like hoisting a beach.
So he had to take me over to the big boat.
Where the little kids were.
Where the little kids were. And I went back on that boat, and you went back on the other. But tell them what you saw. All the wonderful coral reef you saw. What I missed.
Okay, I missed the 20-minute tour. This is what pissed me off. We missed the 20-minute tour. He took us, the coral reef was like the closest to their shop. It was clear they did not want to take us out. So we went to a coral reef that was half dead anyway. It was no more than 4 or 5 feet deep. There was a coral here, a coral there, and some fish going in.
Here a coral, there a coral, everywhere a coral, coral.
Yeah, and very, very uneventful. And after 20 minutes, we were back in the boat, going boom, in, out, thank you, ma'am. That was our snorkeling tour. So I would say that was the biggest disappointment of the trip, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Wouldn't you say that? Next day, we went to the Mayan ruins, which was
Altoon Ha.
We went to the Altoon
Ha,
which was the closest ruin to Belize City.
Yeah.
And the most unimpressive, but because Alex had never seen a ruin, period, it was good for him to see.
And it wasn't a bad ruin. I mean, the history of it's kind of interesting.
Yeah, but you, believe me, you have not seen ruins. If you like that one, you'll wait until you see others.
Yeah, but I liked it a lot. And then
it was very hot, and Alex did climb all the way to the top of the ruin to take photos. And I mean, he had to stop a couple times for breath, but I mean, he was a good trooper. Mm-hmm. I was very proud of him.
So this was a whole place where they did commerce?
Yes.
So it was like a flea market.
Start on this side.
Okay. Now that yet harder left out in discovered.
Yeah, that's where the steps go up.
Yeah, but they just dig it and they find 13 doors.
Yeah.
13 doors in there. And they cover it and leave it. Okay?
Because of the looting?
Yeah, that's
because of the looting, and they want to keep it natural.
But what was it?
It's a temple.
A temple?
Yeah, most of them are temples.
These are all temples?
Yeah. Temples. The structure's going to be over here, the residence and so forth. It's going to be over here. Now, here, it have been noted that 8 to 10,000 people lives here.
Wow.
Okay. 8 to 10,000 inhabitants live, perhaps 300,000 individuals living within the central square.
Wow.
Which is out here. Okay.
It's only about 1.5 square miles.
Square mile.
Wow. So it was heavily populated.
It was heavily populated.
It was heavily populated. and it's mostly like elites. Let's take, for example, the Mayan, like for example you. Mm. You're too big to be a Mayan. Yeah. So if you come in their world, you're an elite. Now with that eliteness, now you got to show your people because you were sent by their gods to rule over them, okay. To preside over yeah. them. Now with that eliteness, now there are certain things that you got to do to show the people that were sent by their gods. For example, the blood dripping. The blood dripping is something like they use a sacrifice. They use the stingray skin, the stingray spine.
Yeah.
And they would pierce some part of their body, mostly the penis. And the blood that comes out there, then they use that and they, you know, a sacrifice.
Yeah.
Okay. Mayan believe that they believe in the underworld, like Chibalba, which is the underworld of the Mayan, that if you should die, there are certain things that you have to do before you get from there.
Mm-hmm.
They also believe that if you die, they take for example, if you have your golds and patries and so forth, somebody got to die to mine those. Like this gentleman right here, he died to mine all of this. And he do that with his will. He's proud to do that, to mine these.
So when he dies, they put all that with him?
Yes, okay.
Show the,
yeah.
the camera.
And that's what, you want to explain about the cocoon trees to the gentleman? Yeah.
Now this tree, most of my grandparents and my ancestors, they use the little cocoons, they open it, they break it open, and what they do, they extract oil from it.
Oil?
Yes, for cooking purposes.
So is it similar to coconut?
Yes, it's similar to coconut. It's a cousin to the coconut. And what we do after we extract the oil, we use the trash from it and we rub it on our skin, and it makes our skin fine
soft,
and beautiful.
Yeah.
Soft and fine and beautiful.
So it's like a coconut butter?
Yes, it's something like coconut butter.
Yeah.
It's something like cocoa butter. Now this tree, people still use this tree up to today. Local Belizeans still use this tree to extract oil for cooking purposes as well as for lotion.
Mm-hmm.
And we still rub our skins with it. Most my grandmother, you can't tell her not to rub her skin with a cahoon. Dr. Pendergrass was an excavator. He was the one that got the contract from Belize to build roads. Now he was an excavator. What he was doing, he was breaking apart rocks basically to build roads and to build other buildings. Now he ran a ground structure B4 over on that side, and what happened was he broke it apart. It was remember I told you it's in its second stage. It has six more stories to go until it has eight stages total. It was in its second stage now. Now what he did, he broke down the other six stages until he realized
that it
was an archaeological site. He realized that someone was living here prior to him coming.
First
he thought it was just rocks. He thought it was a mountain first because it was so high.
Yeah.
Now structure B4 was one of the tallest buildings in Belize. Second to another large archaeological site, which is named Sonantonich in the Cayo district.
Yeah.
Now that is the largest site, the largest building, the largest Mayan site in Belize now.
Belize.
Then you have the largest site in the country of Belize, which is Caracol.
Yeah.
That is the largest site in Belize.
And then Tikal is the largest Mayan site in the world.
In the world, exactly.
Can I go up here?
You could from the front. Okay. You could go up from the front.
The elites were living in these buildings over here?
Yes, sir. The elites were living.
And how many people would live in something like that?
In something like that, it would just be an elite and his family.
So it's like a family house?
Like a family house, yes, sir.
Yeah.
Like the elite and his family would live in that building, another elite and his family would live in this building, et cetera, et cetera.
How about this one straight ahead, the one that's...
This one straight ahead. This one was, this one housed approximately 13 families. It had the reason why they said that was because if you look on that side over on the left hand side, that was actually a door. Now they found 12 other doors on the same level. That was the reason why they say it was approximately 13 families that lived in that building.
And you say they sealed it again?
Yes, they covered it again. That is it, so no one can go inside because due to the fact that they looted that one heavily. Now that one is basically priceless. They looted it.
And that's why it hardly is even visible anymore.
Yes, sir. That's why it's hardly even visible anymore. Now, if someone would break apart all these sites, all these buildings, they would find hundreds of millions of dollars worth of goods in this site.
I'm sure.
That they can sell.
Did they use any of this for sporting events?
Yes, they do. Yes. Meeting and sporting events.
And commerce.
This was basically Wall Street.
Yeah.
This was basically Wall Street for the Mayans.
So they put all their wares out.
All their warehouses, and this is where they come to do trading. I give you a pound of bean, you give me a pound of rice.
Yeah.
So, for the barter system. That's a jade head.
That's a jade head that they found.
Wow.
A jade head, Kenich Aha, which represent Kenich Aha, right? Which means the sun god of the Mayan. All right? Now, they found that in here. What they do here, they take obsidian, and they take
jade as well,
and incense.
We'll go to the top, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And then I explain to you.
These are original.
Yeah.
Not these. All these are original.
Yeah. And this was an altar.
Yes, it is an altar.
Why was it only up this high if the building was higher?
No, I was telling your wife.
Yeah.
I was telling your wife that they just put it, they put this here. All of this was man-made. They put this back here to depict how it used to look.
Oh, I see. So that is not an original altar.
It's not an original altar. The original altar was the same as this one.
But it was like another...
It was up on the other six levels.
They probably should have put...
The same thing. The Mayans, they placed their jade, their incense, and their other obsidian products up here. They burnt it, and they knelt down around it to worship their gods.
They should put a sign on it saying, a recreation.
Then we went, in the afternoon, we went to the cave tubing.
In Jaguar Paw.
Paw?
Paw, Jaguar Paw.
Jaguar Paw. Now, cave tubing, let me say, Belize at one time was underwater, and then I guess with pressure from volcanoes or whatever, it pushed some of these underwater structures up above water.
Mm-hmm.
So what appeared is these incredible limestone caves.
That the Mayans lived in.
That the Mayans lived in.
And there was literally river going through them.
And it was cool enough that they used it as for refrigeration, which mm-hmm. was great. And we hiked up to one of the caves.
Mm-hmm.
It was about a half an hour hike. Alex was a trooper. And then we started, we sat in these inner tubes, and we went through the cave. And it got really dark. We had little lights above us that we could see the walls and the side. And it was so nice. The water was so perfectly clear. And it was so beautiful.
And so cooling.
And so cooling, yeah.
And then we...
what happened when we came out?
Then we came out and you come out in the river.
Mm-hmm.
And we floated down the river.
But you're on a current, so we were on the river a good 10, 15 minutes at least, maybe 20.
Yeah.
And it was great. It was really, really terrific.
Yeah.
Now we have to get Alex whitewater rafting.
Friday we got on a boat and went to San Pedro, which is a very large island.
Mm-hmm.
And it has a lot of beaches, and we rented ourselves a little golf cart, whatever they call it.
Yeah, and that was cute.
Yeah, and
we went all the way down to like a place called
Ramon's Village. Yeah,
which had it was kind of
place to eat on the beach.
It was a resort.
Yeah,
and we had lunch there on the beach and spent some time on the ocean. And then came back and had ice cream in town, and then took the boat back. That was a nice day.
Yeah, it was a really nice day.
My back got burnt because I was so conscious of putting stuff on the front for my sun poisoning, I forgot to put stuff on my back, and it got burnt. Anyway.
Wow.
Yeah.
We'll be right back. Messy, unfixed room.
Some kind of safety problem. Guess what?
It's here we are at dinner at the Great House. The Great House is
our third dinner here.
Our third dinner here, mainly because it was really close to the hotel and we're exhausted. Now, tell them about this couple.
Okay, here's the soap. I have to give you a little background.
Make it quick.
I saw this couple at the airport in Belize. I saw them the day after at our hotel. And then I saw them on the beach. Alex and I are in San Pedro for the day. And we stopped at this nice little place to have lunch. And while we're there, I see this couple on the beach. And she is burnt to a crisp. I mean, it's like in the middle of the day and she's got such a sunburn. He's soothing lather and I'm saying, what a cute little couple in love and everything. So Alex and I are filming and walking around and I walked on the beach and I started talking to both of them. The thing that I remember about him is his eyebrows. He has the most amazing eyebrows I've ever seen. Mm-hmm. They've gotta be waxed. They're just perfectly arched. So we started talking and she had asked me, you know, how long we were together and I said 4 years. And do you have any chips or pistachio?
This is not ceviche. Oh. This is kombu salad.
Oh, okay.
Okay, go continue with your story.
Where are we?
Oh yeah, they were a cute couple, and I met them, and she was really
so
sunburned.
Said, how long are you together? She said, can I tell you a little secret? And he said, yeah. She said, we just met last Saturday, and it got hot and heavy real quick. And Tuesday he called with the tickets, and now it's Friday, and here they are. And they seem very happy and very together. I took a couple pictures of them. I gave her my room number.
I let them cook it the regular way because they have a little piece of lamb, so I'm going to save a piece for your fish.
Say it again.
I got a piece.
Really?
Careful.
Sorry.
Careful.
Sorry.
Okay.
I got a piece of lamb for your fish.
There we go.
Oh, thank you. And here's another one. I'll save this one.
Okay. Now, so anyway, she got the phone number.
She got the phone number. She called me. We didn't see them for a couple days, and I just thought, bad sunburn, really bad sunburn. She called me tonight, and I said, how are the lovebirds doing? They could hear her whispering in the phone. She said, horrible. I said, what do you mean? She said, I can't wait to get back home. So I said, I want to hear the whole story, but obviously he was in the room. So this will continue tomorrow at the airport. I'll get the full story.
Okay, what would you like to know about the vacation?
Well, first of all, tell us in the outline of how you met and then the week later when I met you on the beach.
You had to tell that one.
Yes, we met actually in a nightclub and he had known my friend. And my friend mentioned, spoke about him and I remembered his
eyebrows.
I never saw a picture of him.
Catch those eyebrows.
Yeah, get the eyebrows. Yeah, you got to make sure.
Aren't they beautiful?
So I said, okay. So, well, he was talking to my girlfriend, and I said, wait a second, because he said he was Turkish. I was like, you know my girlfriend, Susie? He's like, yeah. I'm like, I remembered you because the eyebrows, never saw him again. So we went out I think we went out the same night, the next night, and then he invited me to Belize.
So Tuesday he called you with the tickets?
Right, Tuesday night, because we saw each other Sunday, Monday, and Tuesday.
Okay.
So Tuesday night he's like, I'm purchasing the tickets while I'm on the phone.
So it's hot and heavy right now.
It was hot and heavy.
A lot of...
And, but I see there's a problem with this trip. I thought it was a vacation, but I was being analyzed.
We haven't gotten to that yet.
I'm skipping.
So now it's Thursday, and I first came across the two of them at the Belize airport, and I saw you again at the hotel, and then on the beach in San Pedro. So when I finally got to them in San Pedro, you were burned as a crisp. We were having lunch there and saying, look at that poor girl who was going to suffer the next day.
And we did suffer.
And you did suffer. So when I saw you from afar before I met you, you were lathering lotion on her back and being very attentive, and it was very nice. Okay, now fast forward.
We had already broken up.
Yeah, by then.
So. Didn't we break up by then?
I don't know.
By
it
Friday.
Was like a process.
Yeah, I think it took. Yeah, it took one day. We got here Thursday, but like Saturday. We didn't have a fight about it though.
Yeah. No, but we met you on Friday. So if it happened on Saturday,
By Saturday we were broken up already. So it happens Friday, sometime Friday.
Okay.
It was quick.
It was as quick as it started.
Neither of you look particularly grieved by this whole thing.
I'm sorry?
You don't seem grieved by this whole thing.
Because it is what it is.
But I mean, you're not unhappy. You've probably made friends.
I don't want to be his friend. I don't want to be his friend. I don't want to be his friend.
Well,
I like the guy, but don't want to be his friend.
You got to spend a nice holiday together, and that was nice. So you know you can travel together.
Oh, I don't want to be his friend.
I'm going to go to Spain.
Yes, he's going to Spain.
Are you going to be in Spain together?
Oh, no. He's staying at her place. Yeah, he's staying with my parents' place with his friends that I would do for him.
In Spain?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Yes.
We're in Spain.
We are not traveling together, and we're not going to be friends.
Where in Spain are your parents?
Galicia.
He loves Spain.
So, no. And that's it.
So, in retrospect, how would you kind of sum up the last week?
Right, I'm...
From beginning to end.
Then we'll go to you. Now my turn, right?
Okay.
Uh-huh. It was a great time. I had a good time. It was very nice to get to know her. That was the whole point of this trip already. I just wanted her to have a great time as vacation because I know that she was dedicating her time. She could have done 10 million other things instead of coming with me. Mm-hmm. And it was just giving me an opportunity to get to know her as I'm seeking my soulmate. And I wanted to get to know her. And she took it as a way of analyzing her. I would call it, you know, more of a getting to know the person. And I thought traveling together is the best way to get to know somebody.
Absolutely. I think it's called kicking the tires.
Yes, but in 2 days? Hello?
Did you feel the pressure? Was that it?
I felt the pressure. But it was, by that time, it was already over.
So how do you feel?
Wait, he didn't finish. Let him finish.
How do I feel?
How did you feel?
I'm great. I'm glad to get to know her. Mm-hmm. There are wishes, just like everyone. I have my wishes that I wish she was in a state of mind that she could maintain to get to see me and keep in touch with me in a way.
Get to know you better.
Get to know me better and know, be friends basically. Because, you know, just because we couldn't make it successful couples doesn't mean that
it can't be friends. Absolutely.
I don't want to be friends. Thank you. I want a copy of this.
Well, here we are.
Here we are.
The vacation is over with.
Our holiday is coming to an end.
You mean our vacation?
Our holiday.
Vacation.
Holiday.
Vacation. Okay, let's break up. This seems to be the island, the country of breaking up.
You're stuck with me, kiddo.
It's very nice to go traveling to Paris, London, and Rome. It's oh so nice to go traveling. But it's so much nicer, yes, it's so much nicer to come home. It's very nice to just wander the camel route to Iraq. It's oh so nice to just wander, but it's so much nicer, yes, it's oh so nice to wander back. The mamsels and fräulein and the senoritas are sweet, but they can't compete, cause they just don't have what the models have on Madison Ave. It's very nice to be footloose with just a toothbrush and comb. It's oh so nice to be footloose, but your heart starts singing when you're homeward winging across the phone. And you know your fate is where the Empire State is. All you contemplate is the view from Miss Liberty's dome. It's very nice to go traveling, but it's oh so nice to come home.
Here's the happy couple again. You remember what they were saying in Belize? How's it gone on the trip home?
Well, I don't know.
Yeah,
I don't know, but we do like each other.
Are things better now?
Much better.
I see.
So she hasn't made the cut yet.
I know.
So she's still in the running.
No, I'm not in the running. I'm out.
Not in the running?
I'm eliminated.
She wants to be out.
I've been eliminated.
You've been eliminated?
From the beginning.
But maybe you can be friends.
2 days.
Maybe
2 days.
Maybe you can be friends.
Maybe we can be friends. Maybe. 2 days, elimination,
yeah,
2 days.
I think we are already friends. I'm just not sure how soon she can meet me again.
Ah.
Okay. Yeah. So can we be invited to the wedding?
Definitely.
Totally.
Okay.
And it will not be in Belize. I do not like it, Belize. Definitely not in Belize.
Yeah, our honeymoon is not there.
No, not at all.
So all's well that ends well, and to be continued.
To be continued.
No, all's well doesn't end well because our baggage isn't here.
That's true, but to be continued.
Another half hour.
Yeah.
To be continued.